It's Naomi Wolf, and I am so honored and thrilled to be speaking to the American Library Association. I think it's especially appropriate and wonderful to have this opportunity to talk with you about my book, Outrages, Sex, Censorship, and the Criminalization of Love, because of the ALA's long fight against censorship and fight for the right of readers to read. I saw on your Office for Intellectual Freedom's list of banned books of 2019, the most challenged books of 2019, that 8 out of 10 of them had to do with LGBTQ content. And this is directly relevant to the reason that I wrote Outrages, and I want to talk to you about this extraordinary pioneer for the right of readers to read, and for the right of readers to read about love between same-sex couples, because his books would be on that list today, and he was an early demonstrator of the kind of danger that people of his generation faced when they wrote about love between men, in his case. So Outrages is about John Addington Symonds, who this is not a household name, and it should be. He's a largely forgotten outside of small circles of scholarship and queer history. He's a largely overlooked pioneer of the gay rights movement, and really the movement for human rights. And his story is an incredible story of faith in reading and in the 19th century history of the state's experimentation with ways to control speech and to control what people did with each other in bed, to control the body itself. He saw that society could turn on a young writer, a young poet, which is what he had become at that point. He also fell in love early in his youth with someone named W in his writing. It's so moving to see in his handwritten manuscripts, which are at the Morgan Library in New York, how in 1859 and 1860, he wrote this beautiful, if somewhat turgid, love poem that went on and on and on in quatrain after quatrain to this unnamed W, this youth. His memoirs, which are his secret writings of his real inner life, are this heartbreaking record of what it's like to have to be intimate with someone of a gender you're not remotely attracted to, this loneliness in marriage. His wife, no doubt, had the same loneliness, and he was really in a despair, like in a nervous breakdown, kind of self-hating depth of despair, when he found in his 20s Walt Whitman, and specifically he found Leaves of Grass. And this changed his world, just as it changed the worlds of many people at that time who found echoes of a future world that they wanted to live in Leaves of Grass, which is with its celebration of same-sex love between men, as well as all kinds of love between humans for the earth, love for God, and so on. So this totally transformed him. But Leaves of Grass was illegal to sell or to print and distribute in Britain because of a super central law that I write about, so central to librarians, the 1857 Obscene Publications Act. So after this passed in Britain, it chilled 5 generations of writers, and it created this very subjective definition of obscenity. So now someone writing about gay love or about sexuality in general, including like information for women about contraception, as Annie Besant experienced in the 1870s, they were committing crimes. And not only were they committing crimes, but booksellers, libraries, like Moody Circulating Library, which started to censor itself, printers, editors, distributors, all began to censor themselves. And booksellers started to go to jail. There are cases of 2 to 4 months at hard labor for people selling obscene publications, again, with obscenity defined however subjectively. So my book is about how Symonds tried to tell his truths then in code. He would write about men who loved men in classical antiquity, like in studies of the Greek poets. Or he would write about men who loved men in the Renaissance, like his biography of Michelangelo Buonarroti. Or he would write travelogues that were super boring, very well received, but that had a homoerotic frontispiece showing two men holding hands linked together physically. Or he would write very anodyne books of love poems, but before publication, he would change the pronoun of the beloved from male to female. And one of the most extraordinary things he did, and Outrages kind of ends with this amazing revelation of a code he created, was that he told the story of what became the great love of his life. He finally found true love in the form of a gondolier, a Venetian gondolier named Angelo Fusato. And they were very happily married, effectively, even though gay marriage was not a thing that was even considerable at that time. And he told the story of this great love affair, this great marriage, by embedding a code in his memoirs where you put two of his books of poems side by side and read varying verses, skipping verses, and then these two very conventional straight books of poems become a third meta-text, which is a homoerotic poem telling this true story of his great love. He was advocating for a change to the law so that men could love each other. He was in correspondence with Walt Whitman, who became a mentor and a provocateur his whole life, another great love for him, though they never met. And he was keeping these very frank homoerotic poems in a locked black box in his study, showing them only to his closest friends, because at that point, writing those poems was a crime. The point is that Symonds prevailed. After his death, he prevailed. He prevailed, and again, libraries and librarians are become, you know, figures in major characters in the story. Even after Symonds' death, he bequeathed his memoir. He wanted this to be read, and so he embargoed it for 50 years and gave it to the London Library and gave it into the custodianship of his executor. And finally, it was released. And that's what's so incredible about the journey of books and of the evolution of libraries and librarians and printers and publishers. Finally, a scholarly version of the memoirs reached my hands in 2018. And it's amazing that this character, this figure who never gave up trying to tell the truth about love between men and trying to advocate against the criminalization of love between men, finally had his deepest secret narrative of his inner life in print, published, distributed in libraries around the world. From the very start, I was so moved at this figure who so believed that someday he would have readers and that he would have publishers and that the world would change to celebrate the love that he celebrated and spoke up for and advocated for, and that he had this faith, and that even though he didn't live to see how his words became seeds that kind of floated through the air into the future and helped to bring about our modern world, he believed that that could be. And so librarians and printers and publishers and readers that had faith that these ideas had value kept these words alive in spite of every opposition to liberate the future. And the other reason I wanted to write about Symonds, and I hope that you read Outrages and read his incredible story and share it with your own readers in your libraries, is it's also a story of how the state, the modern state, figured out how to police people's most intimate relationships with each other, how to grab the right to police the body and to invade the body, and also how the modern state figured out how to use censorship and fear of prosecution to silence what people say, to quash ideas, and to control the human spirit. You as librarians have always been out front in defense of the human spirit and its right to roam freely among books and ideas. And I think that this story is also a paean to the work that you do, and also a warning that all of us have to support the work of librarians and libraries, of booksellers and printers and publishers, writers and readers, till our last breaths, now more than ever. Thank you so much.